Well, today I'm talking to Eric Zweig, who's a professional sports writer. National Geographic and ESPN teamed up with him to create It's a Numbers Game Football. Thank you so much for talking with me here today.
Oh, thank you for having me.
So in learning a little bit about you, I saw that you have a Joe Theismann autograph. First of all, how did you get it and where is it now?
Yeah, I got that almost 50 years ago. I tell people that I, you know, met Joe Theismann after he broke his ankle and they assumed the Washington Redskins, New York Giants, Monday Night Football, Lawrence Taylor broke an ankle. But no, this was 1972, unless it was 73, Toronto Argonauts, my first favorite sports team. I'm a Canadian. Theismann had broke his ankle earlier that season. I had broken my wrist. My dad and I were at the game. We went down to the sidelines when the Argos were coming out of the tunnel. My dad called to Theismann, asked him if he would sign his son's cast. Joe hobbled over on crutches, said to me, and you can tell it's the early 1970s, said, "Well, kid, signing casts isn't exactly my bag," but he smiled and signed my cast. And oh, I kept it for years, but it did kind of crumble and get kind of gross. And
so it kind of deteriorated. Well, you know, you're a professional sports writer. You've written over 40 books, right, for adults and for kids. Is it primarily sports? And do you have a favorite sport that you like covering?
Well, it's funny. Baseball is actually my favorite sport. Hockey has been my kind of working sport for years. Football was my first favorite sport. But hockey's where I do most of my work is hockey. Most of the books are hockey. I worked for a little more than 20 years for a small Toronto publisher that did media stuff for the NHL before everything went online. So that's most of my work has been hockey, but baseball is my biggest sport and football was my first love.
I have a friend who, his name is Tim Zemmons, and he worked in the NHL. I think he was a referee, if I'm not mistaken. You were a referee, right? Would it be what was that like for you?
God, where do I say I was a referee? But I refereed as a kid. I played hockey till I was about 13 or 14. I only ever played house league, which was sort of the lowest level. I was a good house league hockey player, but I wasn't going to go far in hockey. And sort of to help out in the league where I worked, my dad coached teams. I sometimes helped him. I did referee games. I probably wasn't even as much as 16 or 17 at the oldest when I was doing it, you know, refereeing the younger kids, but I didn't like it. I wasn't particularly good at it. I didn't really like it. But I did do it.
It's a lot of pressure, I'm sure. You know, when I was reading about you, what kind of intrigued me was we're going to talk about your current book, but I was hoping I could talk to you a little bit about your first book. You wrote your first book, Hockey Night, is it Dominion Canada?
Yeah, I probably got some copies behind me if you could. Oh, give me one second.
Yes.
Funny, I've also got my cat bopping around behind me, who was very quiet when I was doing phone interviews, but I'm guessing he's going to jump up.
We'll probably see it.
So this was my first book, Hockey Night in the Dominion of Canada. Yeah. A historical fiction novel. At this point, I did not yet work for the NHL. I did work in a small newsroom. And when it was off season in various sports, we like to still have content. So I had started writing little capsule biographies of Hockey Hall of Fame players that we could run on the system when it wasn't hockey season. And I read about Frank and Lester Patrick, who were two brothers from the early days of hockey, and Cyclone Taylor and News. And I just got this idea for a story in my head and quit my job, which at that point they had fired my boss, who I really like. You know, people say don't quit your day job, but I kind of knew I would never do it part-time. And I remember my father had been a dentist and hated it his whole life.
Yeah.
And had recently retired and got into other things. And I was like 28. And I said to my dad, I want to quit my job. I want to move to the cottage for a year. And I want to work on a book. And he went, you know, go for it. You're not going to get many more chances like this. So, and everything kind of has happened. I mean, it was a small Canadian success. It didn't lose money. I earned a teeny advance on my original, or royalties on my original advance. So it was considered successful.
And early 1900s, right? early 1900s?
It's been around 1910, like in the, up to 1910. And yeah.
Wow.
And it's funny, like I wasn't as big a history buff before I wrote the book. I always liked history somewhat, but since then, like hockey and hockey history and sports history has really become my thing. Like this book being math for kids was like, geez, man, really? You're sure you want me to do this?
Yeah.
But I certainly get as much history of the game as I can in it. And the math was interesting to be able to incorporate.
And probably being like a sports nerd since you were a little kid. I mean, you got started in statistics and all of that. It was helpful in writing the book. When did you think you became like a sports nerd? When did you realize this is like an addiction, you know?
Well, a sports nerd as opposed to just a fan. I mean, like well, again, here, I'm moving over for a second.
Yeah.
When I was in, you know, I'm a Canadian. We say grade five, you guys say fifth grade. When I was in grade five, we had these, I don't know how these survived necessarily. Gosh. These are my school news books. The assignment was always clip something out of the newspaper. You know, you paste it in. You know, like you get your newspaper clipping, you paste it in and you write the summary of what the news story is. And I, you know, 9 days out of 10, it's like last night, the Maple Leafs beat the New York Islanders 4-2, Dave Keon, Gary Monahan, you know, tonight, the Montreal Canadiens play the Chicago Blackhawks, you know, this weekend, the Argos are in the playoffs against, you know, it was all sports until one day my teacher says to me, bring in newspaper clippings other than sports, underline, exclamation mark. And my story the next day is like, this is Mayor David Crombie carrying the Grey Cup football for the Grey Cup game in Toronto. So it was, you know, sports anyway. So, I mean, that's certainly, by grade five, I was certainly a rabid sports fan. I probably didn't become a nerd till later.
Were you playing sports?
I played hockey. I played football. I played baseball, but I was terrible at baseball. It's funny, after the Blue Jays came to Toronto in 1977, my mother had always been a big baseball fan growing up. Toronto had minor league teams. And when Toronto got a major league team, she and my dad, like, we were like first in line to get tickets. And I've been a huge baseball fan since then, but I was a horrible baseball player. I was a pretty good hockey player. I was a great touch football player. I didn't really love to be hit, but I, you know, if you could go pro in touch football, that would have been my game.
Not
anymore.
That.
I used to be really fast and have great hands. Now I'm slow and have meh hands.
You know, it was so much fun learning about you, and something happened to you when you were in the basement of Trent University. Do you remember? It was like a light bulb moment, right?
Yeah. Well, it was actually my second year in university. And I guess I hadn't been down in the basement of the library in the first year. We had to do an assignment basically on you know, how a bill becomes a law, how it's passed through parliament. And in the basement of the library, there's a record, all the records of the debates in parliament, I don't know if there's a similar thing in the United States, are transcribed and published in a book at the end of each year. It's called Hansard. And it's like word for word what was discussed in every discussion and every debate that went on in the House of Commons. And so I had to go down there to find the, you know, the debate I was looking for. And it's like, I turned left instead of right. And on a wall, you know, like that wall behind me, there was a row of the New York Times on microfilm. And I didn't know from microfilm before this. Like microfilm was like spy movie stuff, right? Like
right.
How we'll leak out the plans for the nuclear reactor from Uzbekistan or whatever. And it was like, wow. And it was just like a big film strip. There wasn't anything fancy to it. You loaded it up in the machine. It was like, I can read everything there ever was.
Wow.
And I specifically looked up the seventh game of the 1926 World Series because I wanted to know, there was a moment in that game, a key moment where a grand slam was nearly hit and the ball hooked foul. And I was just always curious, how far foul did it go? Because different reports of it over the years but the New York Times, it didn't report, just long fly ball that went foul. So it kind of made me realize that I liked looking this stuff up and could look this stuff up.
Yes.
And that there was, you still couldn't necessarily find all the right answers. So there was room for, you know, speculative fiction where you could make up stories based on what really happened and no one could prove you were wrong.
Yeah. I see. I remember too. Microfiche is what they called it here.
Yeah.
I remember going down to the library once and discovering that myself and just getting lost in.
Yeah. Newspaper. Oh God. I would just go when I should have been studying. Just like, right. What's new today? Oh, it was great.
I was the same way. You wrote, I think it was about, the 1919 Stanley Cup, was it canceled? It was canceled, right?
The final game was canceled and never played because of the Spanish flu, which became big news over the last couple of years. I was doing a lot of things like this with people telling the story of the 1918 Spanish flu and the 1919 Stanley Cup being canceled. Yeah. I have a YA novel for similar great ages, I guess, as the football book now but that was, again, that was, I guess that's part of my hockey. Like I love the history of sports, and I'd been fascinated, like as a kid, you know, like the Stanley Cup is actually engraved for 1919 with, you know, series incomplete. And I've kind of known that since I was a kid, and it always fascinated me.
That's so interesting. You know, this book it's more than just a sports book. Like I know some young girls that would love this book just because of the math that's involved in it. Right. Huh. And that's what you wrote about this. What makes football a numbers game? I mean, are all sports numbers games?
I think all sports are numbers games, really. Like this is already the fourth in this series. There's a basketball one, a soccer one, and a baseball one. And it's interesting that, like, I've quietly wondered if, like, you know, football fans will be put off by the math, or math fans won't care about the football. But it seems like the other books have been successful, and I haven't heard from a lot of people yet. Like the book is, I don't know when this is actually going to air, but as we're taping this, the book is being released today.
Yes.
So there hasn't been a lot of feedback yet, but people in the offices, you know, children of people that work for National Geographic have told me that their kids love it. I'm not a math guy. Like I'm a history and a geography, and that's like, I like the stories of how the games spread, where they were, who the great players were. But football, and the obvious thing about football is like the numbers are so sort of right there, right? Like they wear big numbers on their sweaters, bigger than other sports. The numbers are right there on the field, counting off the yards, the down sign that they flip over to show. Like there's lots of obvious numbers. And that was like when they said to me, yeah, don't worry about math so much. Statistics and that is all good. All right, I can do this. But then as the book evolved, that was like more math, and more science. And I realized, I've said this in a few interviews I've done with other people today, like, I don't know that being a math genius will make you a better athlete, or being a better athlete will make you a math genius. But I always, like, math and science bored me in school. Most things bored me in school, I have to say. But math and science particularly, I don't know if it bored me. It intimidated me. I wasn't good at it. And I never saw, like, what's the practical value in this? Where will I ever use this in real life? And I realized, like, how much math and science really is kind of behind the scenes in football. Like, I think the great athletes do these things innately. Like Patrick Mahomes, who wrote the foreword to the book, and does a great job explaining how he manages the clock and watches the yardage. But I mean, he's not thinking, to get this ball that far downfield, I need 672 newtons of force behind. But I mean, part of his brain knows that and makes those calculations without even thinking. And I hope that kids will see, you know, math really does have, I mean, people who love math are a whole different breed, and they, you know, it's a language to them. But those of us who don't, we'll appreciate that, you know, there is a lot more math in the world than we think. And even in these games we think are fun and physical, there's a math and science element to them.
Yeah, that's what was so interesting. You were talking about Patrick Mahomes, because reading about that, that's just like, it's just amazing to me that he used that to calculate. Also the illustrations, the photos, everything. It's just a beautiful, There we go.
National Geographic does great books. It's fun to work with them. Gosh. And this one was interesting because there were so many drafts on paper before I even saw a layout of it. And it was hard to imagine how, I mean, I'd done a couple of books for them already, so I know they do a good job. And even when I started getting, you know, PDF files, it always looked so small and cramped. When I actually saw the book and it's big and it's bright and it's beautiful, it was like, wow, this is a good book.
Yeah.
I hope people like it.
And you have these little things in the book, right? The little try this activities. Do you remember, like, offhand one or two that you could mention?
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, again, like, this is the fourth book in a series. And when they first came to me, I think the basketball book was completely done and a soccer book was underway. So they sent me the basketball book so I could see what the try this was. And they have to be a little bit mathy, but also a little bit physical. So I like, it was easy, like, you know, go out with a ball and a friend and count off the yards, see how far you can kick it, see how far you can throw it, see how many times you can throw it before you drop it. Those were easy.
Yeah.
But that was, they wanted slightly more intellectual tasks than that, I guess. So one of the ones we have in the book, and it's very simplified in the book because it says in the book, I can't remember the page, you've got the book in front of you, but it's the try this, it's schedule mania, I think they call it. And it's how, I've always known the NHL, the NFL schedule was based on sort of how the teams did the previous year, like where you finished in your division, like first, second, third, fourth, you know, you'll play teams that finished first or in the other division. And there's always a rotation of how between the two conferences and the divisions, who you're going to play each year and how it rotates around. It's very, and but it says in the book, it's like five guys and 100 computers to figure this out. So we had to get a 2-page spread that a 12-year-old could grasp in minutes. So it's not exactly making the schedule, but it does show you, like, based on your results this year, who will you be playing next year? So yeah. I mean, that one was a fun one to try and come up with, and it was way harder to explain it than I realized it would be.
Yeah,
but it was a neat one.
I think kids are gonna, and adults too, are gonna just love this book. And do you play fantasy football?
I don't. I mean, it's funny, like, I've never been much of a gambler. I always feel like people say, oh, I can't even watch a game if I don't have something riding on it. But to me, I'm a sports fan. Like the sport of the game is enough for me. Like, yes. I don't need, so I don't get involved. I'm also like, I'm way more sad about losing money than I am excited about winning money. So I don't like to risk my money. So
I get that. I'm with you there. Hey, listen, Eric, it's been so much fun talking to you today. You can hold up that book if you've got it there for me. It's available at your local bookstore and online. It just came out today. Yeah. Where can people reach out to you, Eric?
Oh, for me, if you want to get in touch with me, I have a website, ericzweig.com. It's just, well, I'll just show it close enough so you can see it. ericzweig.com. It is mostly hockey stories on my website, but football stories too, and information about my books and about me. And an email address, though, you can reach me if you have questions.
Thank you so much for your talk today, your conversation. I really appreciate it.
Oh, you're very welcome.